Hey there, welcome to this day number 351. It gives me great joy to share the richness of God's Word with you. And today we read Habakkuk 1 and 2, the first reading in Isaiah 55 and Revelation 8.
The book of Nahum ended with these words about Nineveh. There is no healing for your wound. Your injury is fatal. All who hear of your destruction will clap their hands for joy. Where can anyone be found who has not suffered from your continual cruelty? And now we turn to the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk preached at the time when it was clear, through prophecy and conquest taking place, that Babylon would defeat Judah. This was between 627 and 605 BC, which would have been when Jeremiah, Nahum, and Zephaniah were living, and Daniel may have been a young boy. We often hear people questioning how God could be good and loving and allow various disasters or evil things to happen. And Habakkuk asks that question and another. Why do you, God, use a nation that is more sinful than we are to punish us? Mears gives a neat outline of the three chapters of Habakkuk. Watch and see, stand and see, and kneel and see. Habakkuk 1. This is the message that the prophet Habakkuk received in a vision. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere, I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, so that justice has become perverted. The Lord replied, "Look around at the nations, look and be amazed, for I am doing something in your own day, something you wouldn't believe even if someone told you about it. I am raising up the Babylonians, a cruel and violent people. They will march across the world and conquer other lands. They are notorious for their cruelty and do whatever they like. Their horses are swifter than cheetahs and fiercer than wolves at dusk. Their charioteers charge from far away. Like eagles, they swoop down and devour their prey. On they come, all bent on violence. Their hordes advance like a desert wind, sweeping captives ahead of them like sand. They scoff at kings and princes and scorn all their fortresses. They simply pile up ramps of earth against their walls and capture them. They sweep past like the wind and are gone, but they are deeply guilty, for their own strength is their God. O Lord my God, my Holy One, you are eternal. Surely you do not plan to wipe us out. O Lord, our Rock, you have sent these Babylonians to correct us, to punish us for our many sins. But you are pure and cannot stand the sight of evil. Will you wink at their treachery? Should you be silent while the wicked swallow up people more righteous than they are? Are we only fish to be caught and killed? Are we only sea creatures that have no leader? Must we be strung up on their hooks and caught in their nets while they rejoice and celebrate? Then they will worship their nets and burn incense in front of them. These nets are the gods who have made us rich, they will claim. Will you let them get away with this forever? Will they succeed forever in their heartless conquests? Habakkuk chapter 2. I will climb up to my watchtower and stand at my guard post. There I will wait to see what the Lord says and how he will answer my complaint. Then the Lord said to me, write my answer plainly on tablets so that a runner can carry the correct message to others. This is for a future time. It describes the end, and it will be fulfilled. If it seems slow in coming, wait patiently, for it will surely take place. It will not be delayed. Look at the proud. They trust in themselves, and their lives are crooked. But the righteous will live by their faithfulness to God. Wealth is treacherous, and the arrogant are never at rest. They open their mouths as wide as the grave, and like death they are never satisfied. In their greed they have gathered up many nations and swallowed many peoples. But soon their captives will taunt them. They will mock them, saying, what sorrow awaits you, thieves! Now you will get what you deserve. You've become rich by extortion, but how much longer can this go on? Suddenly your debtors will take action. They will turn on you and take all you have, while you stand trembling and helpless. Because you have plundered many nations, now all the survivors will plunder you. You committed murder throughout the countryside and filled the towns with violence. What sorrow awaits you who build big houses with money gained dishonestly. You believe your wealth will buy security, putting your family's nest beyond the reach of danger. But by the murders you committed, you have shamed your name and forfeited your lives. The very stones in the walls cry out against you, and the beams in the ceilings echo the complaint. What sorrow awaits you who build cities with money gained through murder and corruption? Has not the Lord of heaven's armies promised that the wealth of nations will turn to ashes? They work so hard, but all in vain. For as the waters fill the sea, the earth will be filled with an awareness of the glory of the Lord. What sorrow awaits you who make your neighbors drunk, who force your cup on them so you can gloat over their shameful nakedness. But soon it will be your turn to be disgraced. Come, drink, and be exposed. Drink from the cup of the Lord's judgment, and all your glory will be turned to shame. You cut down the forests of Lebanon. Now you will be cut down. You destroyed the wild animals, so now their terror will be yours. You committed murder throughout the countryside and filled the towns with violence. What good is an idol carved by a man or a cast image that deceives you? How foolish to trust in your own creation, a god that can't even talk. What sorrow awaits you who say to wooden idols, wake up and save us. To speechless stone images you say, rise up and teach us. Can an idol tell you what to do? They may be overlaid with gold and silver, but they are lifeless inside. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him.
Now we turn to Isaiah 55. At the beginning of Isaiah 54, we heard words quoted by Paul in Galatians 4:27. Sing, O childless woman, you who have never given birth. Break into loud and joyful song, O Jerusalem, you who have never been in labor. At the point where Paul was quoting this, he was using Sarah as a metaphor for the New Jerusalem, which he says is our mother. Also, perhaps you noticed another interesting thing in Isaiah 54. In just a few days in our reading of Revelation, we will hear about precious gems used in building the New Jerusalem. So I quote from Isaiah 54, O storm-battered city, troubled and desolate,
I will rebuild you with precious gems and make your foundations from lapis lazuli. I will make your towers of sparkling rubies, your gates of shining gems, and your walls of precious stones. Isaiah 55. Is anyone thirsty? Come and drink, even if you have no money. Come, take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Why spend your money on food that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you will eat what is good. You will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, and you will find life. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the unfailing love I promised to David. See how I used him to display my power among the peoples. I made him a leader among the nations. You also will command nations you do not know, and peoples unknown to you will come running to obey, because I, the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, have made you glorious. Seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him now while he is near. Let the wicked change their ways and banish the very thought of doing wrong. Let them turn to the Lord that he may have mercy on them. Yes, turn to our God, for he will forgive generously. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. The rain and snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry. It is the same with my word. I send it out, and it always produces fruit. It will accomplish all I want it to, and it will prosper everywhere I send it. You will live in joy and peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song, and the trees of the field will clap their hands. Where there were thorns, cypress trees will grow. Where nettles grew, myrtles will sprout up. These events will bring great honor to the Lord's name. They will be an everlasting sign of his power and love. We turn now to Revelation 8. Remember that in Revelation 7, the first group we saw was the 144,000 from the tribes of Israel. 144,000 is 12 times 12,000. 12,000 from each tribe. Remember, numbers in Revelation have symbolic meanings. Now the question is whether the next group that John sees is the same group or a different one. He says that they were a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language. Look closer at God's word and you will always see that it's very deep. Look closely at the names of the 12 tribes. Notice that the list has been altered from the normal list repeated in the Old Testament. Which tribes are missing? Which tribe is doubled up? Note that the answers to this may hold a clue as to whether the 144,000 is made up of only ethnic Jews. There is gold to dig for here. Revelation 8. When the Lamb broke the seventh seal on the scroll, there was silence throughout heaven for about half an hour. I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and they were given seven trumpets. Then another angel with a gold incense burner came and stood at the altar. And a great amount of incense was given to him to mix with the prayers of God's people as an offering on the gold altar before the throne. The smoke of the incense, mixed with the prayers of God's holy people, ascended up to God from the altar where the angel had poured them out. Then the angel filled the incense burner with fire from the altar and threw it down upon the earth. And thunder crashed, lightning flashed, and there was a terrible earthquake. Then the seven angels with the seven trumpets prepared to blow their mighty blasts. The first angel blew his trumpet, and hail and fire mixed with blood were thrown down on the earth. One third of the earth was set on fire, one third of the trees were burned, and all the green grass was burned. Then the second angel blew his trumpet, and a great mountain of fire was thrown into the sea. One third of the water in the sea became blood, one third of all things living in the sea died, and one third of all the ships on the sea were destroyed. Then the third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from the sky, burning like a torch. It fell on one third of the waters and on the springs of water. The name of the star was Bitterness. It made one third of the water bitter. And many people died from drinking the bitter water. Then the fourth angel blew his trumpet, and one third of the sun was struck, and one third of the moon, and one third of the stars, and they became dark. And one third of the day was dark, and also one third of the night. Then I looked, and I heard a single eagle crying loudly as it flew through the air. Terror! Terror, terror to all who belong to this world because of what will happen when the last three angels blow their trumpets.
Let's pray together. Our just and holy God, you are the Lord of heaven's armies. Lord, we know that there is a time coming when you will judge the earth and all its residents for the terrible sins that have happened. And then you say in your word, you will make all things new, and you will give us a new Jerusalem. I note that these judgments were in response to prayers. These trumpet blasts are intimately connected with the prayers of the saints and the incense that were offered just before they sounded. This, Lord, reminds me to pray for your justice. Lord, it is right that you will punish those who traffic in people, who murder people, who oppress people, who cause all manner of cruelty to others. Yes, Lord. There is a time where, if you are our just God, all of these things demand that you will bring about a retribution. Therefore, help us to be salt and light here in this world. Help us to warn others of judgment. Give us wisdom, Lord, to say that you are the just God who will bring each person to court. And I thank you, Lord, that our lawyer, Christ Jesus, will be there. Help us to live today glorifying him.